If you're able, stand and turn with me to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. Very familiar text. Matthew chapter 7. The first gospel in the New Testament. We're going to see what is being said on this morning. Matthew chapter 7. We're going to look at verses 15 through 23. Matthew 7, verses 15 through 23. And I'll be reading from the New King James Version on this morning. Starting at verse 15 of Matthew 7, it reads as follows. It says, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will know them. Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, 'Lord, Lord, have not we prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name?' And then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness.'" Let us pray. Lord, we thank you on this morning, Lord, for everything that you have done in our lives. Lord, as I stand here and proclaim your word on this morning, I pray that you would decrease all of me and increase all of you. Holy Spirit, have your way. It's in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We're in a new series on this morning. This new series is entitled, "Beware of Wolves." Beware of Wolves. The subtitle is also entitled, "Beware of Wolves," as well. Grace Center, many years ago, when First Lady and I were dating, we were in another state and we were going to visit my cousin in North Carolina. We drove to his home, and at that time I drove a pickup truck. When we got to his home, we parked at his home and we got out the vehicle. Elder Coleman, as we're heading up the walkway to get to the door of his home, we both notice at the same time this dog is coming our way. Now, we both notice the dog at the same time, Jay. We both notice this big old dog coming in our direction. But before I could even look at my girlfriend at the time, First Lady, before I could look at her and say dog, she was already gone. When I turned around, Dawn, I only saw her legs get into the back of that pickup truck. Didn't whip out any keys, didn't try to open up any doors. All I saw was legs hopping into this pickup truck. I don't know where this dog came from. I don't know who the dog belonged to. But maybe it would have been a little bit helpful, Deacon Drew, if some signs were up saying, "Beware of dog." In the scripture, Jesus is talking, but he's not talking about dogs.
He said, beware of wolves. It's interesting that even here in the text, Jesus is talking about false teachers, but when he talks about them, he compares them to wolves. What kind of animal is a wolf? And why would Jesus even compare false teachers to this animal? Allow me for just a few moments on this morning to give you just some characteristics of a wolf. Wolves have a strong sense of smell. A very, very strong sense of smell. They can smell things from miles away. Under good conditions, when a wolf will howl, you can even hear a wolf up to 10 miles when they howl under perfect conditions. Wolves, they also prey on the young, or the sick, or the weak. In other words, they try to find and try to catch the most vulnerable animal that they can find. It's also interesting to note that when wolves kill, they don't kill for sport. They kill for survival. So here in the text, I find it interesting that when Jesus talked about false teachers, he compared them to wolves. To paint the picture of what's happening here in the text, let me give you the backdrop of what's happening here. Jesus is teaching and preaching one of the most famous sermons of all time. As a matter of fact, it's the best sermon of all time. I don't care about the other preachers you see on television, or the preachers you see on, or hear on the radio. This is the best sermon of all time. This sermon is a sermon entitled The Sermon on the Mount. In this sermon, he talked about a lot of different things. The Sermon on the Mount, it started in Matthew chapter 5, and it goes all the way to Matthew chapter 7. And a variety of topics Jesus talks about in the Sermon on the Mount. He talked about the Beatitudes or the blessings. He talked about being salt and light. He talked about anger. He talked about adultery. He talked about divorce. In this sermon, he talked about loving your enemies. He talked about how to pray, how to fast. He talked about worry. He also talked about how we should judge one another as well. He also talked about the wide gate and the narrow gate. If you have any questions in your life, you just may find it in the Sermon on the Mount. So here you have Jesus preaching and teaching the greatest sermon ever with all of these great topics, and then he decides to talk about false prophets. He says, beware of false prophets. Beware means to look out for, to be cautious, to be alert. Beware of what? Beware of who? What am I looking out for? You're watching out for false prophets. False prophets. Not real prophets, but false prophets. You know what false is. We've all taken tests in school before. Where they may have a question and you have to decide whether it's true or it's false. You have a 50-50 chance of getting the answer right. It's a true and false question. And you have to sometimes fill in the bubble whether it's true or whether it is false. Later on in the sermon here, Jesus shows us how to fill in the bubble. He says, beware of false prophets. And it's interesting, he says, beware of false prophets. And he says something else also in the text. He says something in verses 13 and 14 before he said, beware of false prophets. And we have to look at what he said, because it's interesting that he said, beware of false prophets at the time that he said it.
So let's look at verses 13 and 14 and see what he said before he said beware. He says in verse 13, he says, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go in by it, because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life. And there are few who find it. So Jesus, he talked about the narrow gate and the wide gate. And then he started talking about false prophets. What is the narrow gate? What is the wide gate? The narrow gate is a gate that a lot of people try to avoid. It's a gate that may lead to a little persecution. It's a gate that may lead to a little backstabbing, a little disappointment from time to time. But in the end, it leads to eternal life. On the other hand, you have the wide gate. Many people will make their way and find the wide gate. People enjoy walking through the wide gate. There are a lot of pleasures through the wide gate. But unlike the narrow gate, the end does not lead to eternal life, but the end leads to destruction. So Jesus picks up in verse 15 by talking about these false prophets, and he says, beware of them. In other words, false prophets and false teachers love to teach about the wide gate. The wide gate is so much more appealing. The wide gate. The wide gate looks like so much fun. The wide gate looks so attractive. But the wide gate leads to destruction. Beware of wolves. Beware of wolves who teach and love wide gate doctrines. Beware of wolves who teach and love wide gate philosophies, wide gate theories, wide gate teachings, wide gate sermons. Grace Center, beware of those wolves. Watch out for these false prophets, because they would not come in wolves' clothing, but they would come in the clothing of sheep. In other words, they will appear, watch this, they're going to appear to be non-aggressive, meek and mild-tempered sheep. Don't be fooled, because they are not sheep, they're wolves. But they're not just wolves. Jesus calls them ravenous wolves. Ravenous means greedy. It means extremely hungry. Ravenous wolves. In the Greek, it also means robber or extortioner. That's what it means in the original text. Extortion. Extortion is when you try to blackmail someone to give you something, and if they don't do it, they'll expose you. These are the ones Jesus said, beware of. Extortion is illegal. Extortionist has no integrity. Extortionist has no, or has lack of character. Beware of these wolves. On the outside, they look like sheep. They talk like sheep. They walk like sheep. They may even act like sheep. And they may even do sheepish kind of things. But although they may do sheepish kind of things, they're not sheep. They're wolves. They don't care about your well-being. They don't care about what's happening in your world. They don't care about your husband just told you he's going to leave you. They don't care that you just got laid off. They don't care that you have to go right back to the doctor again. They don't care anything about that. How do I know that? Because they're not sheep. They're wolves. They're wolves, but they're not just wolves, Elder Coleman. They are ravenous wolves. Vicious, ferocious, robbers and extortionists. And Jesus himself said, beware of them. Grace Center, it's important that we watch out for these false prophets. And we watch out for these false teachers because they have infiltrated the churches. And Jesus felt that it was important to tell his disciples then, but it's also important to tell you all today.
Yeah.
But don't fret, Grace Center, because there is a way that we can detect and disciple and differentiate sheep from wolves. How do we do that? I'm glad you asked. It's an open book test on today. The answer is found in verse 16. Jesus said, watch this, he says, you will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Notice what Jesus first said. He said, you will know them by their fruits. In other words, sooner or later, their actions are going to reveal who they really are. You see, a wolf can only pretend for so long. Because eventually the wolf is going to slip up. And the wolf is going to get too comfortable around the sheep. And when the wolf gets too comfortable around the sheep, the wolf is not going to let out, or the wolf is going to let out a howl, and he's not going to let out the sound of a sheep. And when he let out a howl instead of the sound of a sheep, the other sheep are going to look at the wolf, and they're going to start asking some questions. They're going to say, what did you just say? What did you just do? You're not supposed to be howling. You're supposed to be making the sound that we make. We're not making the same camp sound. So the sheep will start asking questions about this wolf. They'll say, do that again. That don't sound like us. We need for you to do that again. Why is your nose different than our nose? Why are you so much larger than we are? Why do your ears even shape like that? And how do you run so fast? Because now you have sheep asking questions. Because the wolf has revealed his hand. The wolf has slipped up. Because you can only pretend but for so long. And even Jesus gives us the formula on how to spot them. He said, do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? In other words, thorn bushes and thistles don't produce grapes or figs, which is a way of saying nothing good can come from listening to false teachers and false teaching. I think that bears worth repeating. Nothing good can come from listening to false teachers or false teaching. And unfortunately, we have a lot of false teachers and false teaching in the churches. They're howling, but they ain't saying nothing. I know that's not good grammar. I promise you, I did go to public school, but it felt good to say it just like that. I'm a country boy. They are howling, but they ain't saying nothing.
Yeah.
They make a lot of noise, but they ain't saying nothing. They're screaming and hollering, Elder Coleman, but they ain't saying nothing. They want you to buy miracle water from Israel and send you handkerchiefs in the mail. They're making a lot of noise, but they ain't saying nothing. And the reason they're not saying anything is because they ain't got nothing to say, because they're not sheep, they're wolves. Yeah, Jesus continues by comparing a good tree to good fruit and a bad tree to bad fruit. And he says, you will know them by their fruit. In other words, their actions will always tell them. He even continues in verse 21. And then he says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Grace Center, I know this may come as a shock to you this morning, but not everyone that comes to church is saved. Now, I know that's a shocker this morning. I know you call everybody that walk through the doors are saved, but not everyone that comes to church is saved. Not everyone that raises their hand is saved. Not everyone that says hallelujah is saved. Not everyone that says praise Jesus is saved, because you will have false prophets, but you also will have false followers. They pretend they love Jesus. They pretend to be righteous. They pretend to be holy. But Jesus himself said, hold up. Not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter in. Not everyone, but only those who do the will of my Father in heaven. What's the will of the Father in heaven? His will is to receive his Son, Jesus Christ. And how do you do that? You do it by confessing with your mouth and believing in your heart that he came and he died for you. That's the will of the Father. Jesus continues on in verse 22. He says, many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? So they prophesied in his name. They cast out demons in his name. They've done many wonders in his name. And what was Jesus' response to this? Let's look at verse 23. Verse 23 says, and then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Hold on. There's tension in the text. They prophesied in his name. They cast out demons in his name. And they did many wonders in his name. So what's the problem? The problem is they don't have a personal relationship with him. That's the problem. Sure, they perform miracles, but a miracle is simply something that happens by a supernatural power. That's what a miracle is. So a miracle can be done by the power of a divine nature, or a miracle can be done by a satanic power. A supernatural power can do miracles. Yeah. So that supernatural power can either be divine or it can be satanic. You watch people by their fruit, by their actions. They claim to know Jesus, but they really don't know Jesus. Because if they knew Jesus, Jesus would also know them. Oh, let me say that again. If they knew Jesus, Jesus would also know them. I'm not talking about Jesus knowing about them as far as their existence. I'm talking about Jesus not knowing them as far as them being one of his own. Jesus said, I never knew you. And the reason I never knew you is because you never knew me. Yeah. I gave you the opportunity to know me. Yeah. That time when I sent someone to you to witness to you, but you pushed them away. That time when I woke you up in the middle of the night nudging you to receive me, but you pushed me away. Sunday after Sunday, when the preacher gives the invitation to receive me, you stayed right in your seat Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, and you pushed me away. Therefore, I never acknowledged you as my own, because you never acknowledged me as being your Savior. I gave you chance after chance after chance. I never knew you. These are the individuals that Jesus is talking about. These are the ones that Jesus is saying, I never knew you. Yeah. They have one foot in and one foot out. How do you know that, Pastor? At the end of the verse. Still an open book test. At the end of the verse, he says, watch this, depart from me, watch this, you who practice, keyword practice, you who practice lawlessness. You see, when you practice, you're trying to get better at something. I love the Bible. When you practice, you're trying to get better at something. So these individuals here are not practicing holiness. They're not practicing on how to live right, but they're practicing lawlessness. Living like there are no laws. Living any kind of way they want to live. And Jesus said, I never knew you. These are the ones he's talking about. Grace standard, there will be many on that day that will not enter in into the kingdom of heaven. You will have these false teachers, and you will also have these false followers. Beware of wolves. Let me point something else out in the text. We are a teaching ministry here, so we like to scream, holler, and say hallelujah a whole lot here, but we also teach. So by the time you leave here, you can apply what you learn in church when you leave. It's something else in the text that we need to look at here. I told you earlier that we came out of a 3-month series entitled Defenders of the Faith, where we talked about how you can properly defend the faith and know what you're talking about when you're talking to individuals. And it's something in the text, Elder Cohen, that we need to look at. You see, many religions make the claim that Jesus was just a man. That's a theory out there. That's another religion and another cult that talks about that. They say Jesus was just a man. And you have false teachers that also make this claim. Well, if you pay close attention to verses 22 and 23, let's just read it again. And we'll see that Jesus also claimed to have the authority of God and not man. Let's just look at it again. We're in church. Verse 22 says, men will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name and cast out demons in your name and done many wonders in your name? Watch this. And then this is Jesus talking, and then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from who? Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. These verses clearly show us that Jesus Christ is also God. He's part of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. But you have false teachers who say otherwise, but not according to Scripture. When Jesus came to earth, he also came to earth as God himself, wrapped up in flesh. He was wrapped up in flesh here. I'm almost done. I've given you the characteristics of wolves, but let me also give you the characteristics of sheep. I think it's only appropriate that I also give you some characteristics of a shepherd as well. You see, a shepherd normally walks in front of the sheep. They walk in front of the sheep to lead the sheep and to guide the sheep. And then sometimes the shepherd will sometimes sing as he's leading the sheep. This was a way that the sheep would know the voice of the shepherd. Shepherds will also carry a rod and a staff. A rod was between 5 to 6 feet, and the shepherd would place the rod in their belt. The rod would be used as a weapon. Therefore, if any predators try to harm the sheep, the shepherd would take the rod out, and the shepherd would beat back the predators. He would use the rod as protection. But shepherds also use something we call a staff. The staff is much longer than the rod, and the staff has a hook at the end of it. The staff is used to guide the sheep. Every once in a while, a sheep may get away. When the sheep tries to get away, the shepherd would reach out the staff and bring and steer the sheep into its right course, in the right direction. The staff would also be used to pull the sheep out of situations where the sheep is having a difficult time getting out of. The, that staff, when sheep would find themselves in difficult situations, the shepherd would take the end of the staff and bring that sheep right on back to where the sheep is supposed to be. But something interesting about this staff is that at the bottom of the staff is a spoon-shaped shovel at the end of the shaft. The shepherd sometimes would get some mud or get some dirt, and when a sheep goes off, the shepherd would take the bottom of that staff and flick some mud or some dirt at the sheep to get the sheep's attention to say, "Hey, come back over here." Because sometimes sheep will get off course. Sometimes sheep will leave church. Sometimes sheep will do things that sheep are not supposed to do. And when the sheep gets off course, the shepherd will take the bottom of that staff and flick some mud or flick some dirt at the sheep and say, "Hey, get back over here." I'm closing. This is what the shepherd did. You see, Great Center, there are some wolves that love to take advantage of sheep. They love to manipulate sheep. They love to harm sheep. In other words, they prey on harmless sheep. But if you have a good shepherd, like we do, that shepherd knows how to use his rod, he knows how to use his staff. He'll use the rod to beat back predators from attacking the sheep. He'll protect the sheep with the rod. Things come up against you, he'll protect the sheep. But when the sheep is in danger, he knows how to also pull out his staff as well. When the sheep gets off course, he knows how to use that staff. That's what a good shepherd does. He'll take his staff and he'll reach down and pull the sheep where it's supposed to be. That's what a good shepherd does. And if you fall into a mess, a good shepherd knows how to use that same staff to pull you out of your mess. Grace Center, no matter how many wolves are out there, we have a good shepherd by the name of Jesus. He protects, he provides, he leads, he guides, but most importantly, he saves. And depending on the situation, it determines whether he used the rod or whether he used the staff. He'll use the staff to beat back circumstances and situations that has the potential to harm you. He'll use that same staff to say, "Hey, come on back home. I need you to get right back over here." But he'll use the rod to say, "Hey, you're not going to harm my child. You're not going to harm this person. You're not going to harm them." So he'll use the rod to beat off predators, to beat off wolves. But he'll use the staff because sometimes we find ourselves into some situations that's dark. We'll find ourselves in some situations we can't get out of ourselves. Because if you know anything about sheep, sheep are not the smartest animals there are. And sometimes, if you haven't found out now, I'm talking about you, I'm talking about me. We are sheep. And sometimes we'll find ourselves in situations that we never should have been in. And sometimes we did it to ourselves. But a good shepherd knows how to take out his rod. And sometimes he'll reach down deep. For some of you, he'll reach down real deep. Do you see no fishing pole? The fishing pole extends out. For some of us, he has to extend out his staff. Because some of us have done many things and found ourselves into some dark, gloomy places. But he whipped out his staff. And he went down deep. He went down deep. He extended the staff so far and he went down. He took that staff and he opened up that staff because we found ourselves in situations and circumstances that we could not get out of. If we could have got out of it, we would have. But we called on the good shepherd. Oh, yeah, the good shepherd. Don't make me quote Psalm 23. I said, the good shepherd took that staff out. Reach down deep and pull us back to the end of that staff and say, "Hey, I need you to get back over here." Oh, record. I should be in the grave. I shouldn't be a pastor. I shouldn't be a proclaimer of the word. But a long time ago, Jesus, he took his time. For me, he went.
The church should feel the same way. Beware of these wolves.